Hello there. Welcome to the Saroy channel. Thank you so very much for joining me this evening, wherever you are in the world. And I do hope that you're incredibly well and that you've had the most fabulous, phenomenal day. But before we get started, don't forget to get that phenomenal cup of hot chocolate or coffee, because who doesn't need a good beverage when you're about to listen to a great story? And I've got a fabulous story for you tonight. Dear Sarah and all your lovely listeners, my name is Niles and I have an absolutely extraordinary Bigfoot encounter to share with you that I consider to be one of a kind. My Bigfoot encounter happened in 1987 in the Ozarks when I was 30 years old at the time. Growing up, I'd always been considered the type of person that would never ever get married. My friends just believed I was not the settling down type. I'd independently travelled extensively, especially all over North America. I loved camping, fishing, mountain climbing and canoeing. I taught wilderness survival skills once a week and also assisted the Boy Scouts from time to time, teaching them techniques such as tying knots and making campfires. I was in my element because I loved everything to do with the great outdoors, and life was an enormous adventure for me. Of course, at the time I was interested in girls, but dating was not something that actually appealed to me, and I was a disaster at chatting up girls. My biggest problem was that I was painfully shy, self-effacing, and exceedingly reserved. I was not a bad-looking fellow, and some women described me as a great catch, because I was rugged and handsome, 6 foot tall, an athletic build, dark hair and blue eyes. However, good looks are not enough to land you a good girl. It also requires the skill of a seductive, charming tongue, something I clearly lacked in my repertoire. I had been on multiple dates, all with disastrous, unfavourable outcomes. One woman went so far as to escape from me during our dinner by excusing herself by going to the bathroom and climbing through the back toilet window at the restaurant and making a hasty escape. We had sat there in cumbersome, somewhat awkward silence for a very long time, and I didn't know what the heck to say. And I know I appeared standoffish because I was so reticent and repressed. I remember I was completely tongue-tied at the time. I must have come across as a complete fumbling idiot, so I cannot say I blame her for running off like that. I gather she told her girlfriends that she would have had more fun with a piranha than with someone as timid and skittish as I was, because to her the gawky silence over dinner was utterly deafening. On another date, in agonizing nervous attempt to make polite, meaningful conversation, I commented on how much the woman was actually enjoying her food, and I meant it as a big compliment. I proceeded to boldly say that I could tell she loved her food because she looked remarkably healthy. The woman then threw a glass of wine in my face and told me she did not need a jerk like me in her life, and how dare I call her fat. I was not even suggesting she was fat, but there I was, putting my foot in it all over again. Then on another date set up for me by a friend of mine, it also inauspiciously ended in disaster. The woman was so fussy and punctilious about her order and kept sending all her dishes back to the kitchen, complaining bitterly all the time. I told you I want the dressing separate from the salad. Not on the salad. Are you stupid or what? She said to the waitress, explaining to me that she couldn't abide airheads. The waitress brought her the salad again with the dressing on the side that she had had insisted upon, along with a glass of lemonade that she had also ordered. Once again my date exploded, saying, "I told you I did not want a lemon piece in my lemonade. Why did you not listen? Are you deaf or something?" I remember the poor waitress looked so belittled and humiliated as my dates caused such a commotion about absolutely everything that even the customers at other tables were looking at each other and whispering among themselves, drawing uncomfortable attention to our table, which I could have well done without because I'm not the most attention-seeking exhibitionist at the best of times. When the waitress brought our main course, my date started to shriek at the waitress like a headmistress lecturing a pupil for very bad behaviour. "I told you that I do not want any butter on my chicken breast." "That's not butter," the waitress insisted. "It's just lemon juice with a touch of parsley in it, I promise you." "Do I look stupid?" went on my date in a raised voice. The waitress shook her head. "Good," she said. "Now take my chicken back and make it the way I ordered it." I watched the waitress scuttle away with a terrified look on her face, and her eyes were brimming with tears. "Do you not think you were a little hard on the poor girl?" I asked, leaping to the waitress's defence. "I mean, she's trying her very best to give us good service, and I think she's doing a great job. She's trying very hard to please us." My date gasped at me in horror. "You are taking sides with the waitress," she said. "That's appalling. I'm your date, and you're treating that airhead better than me. You disgust me. You clearly do not know how to treat a lady right," she said. I watched her rising from her seat, grabbing her handbag and thrusting it under her arm. "Right, I'm out of here," she said, storming out of the restaurant in a huff, making a huge spectacle of herself as she swaggered off, delighting in the attention she was arousing among all the customers. "Tell that friend of yours to stop setting me up on such crap dates," she hissed, and she finally left the premises. I still remember an elderly couple looking at me so piteously on the opposite table, and the purple-rinsed elderly woman whispered to me, "You're better off without him, love." I settled the bill and raced out of the restaurant as fast as I possibly could. I don't think I've ever been so humiliated in my entire life. In that moment, I decided that I would never, ever date again. One day at a local diner with a friend of mine called Mike, I met a very attractive brunette, a waitress called Celeste, and we went on a couple of dates together. She was a garrulous yet charming woman who loved talking about herself, which helped me significantly with my painful reticent shyness, and to make matters even better, she never asked me about myself at all. At that time, I did consider her lack of interest in me not a bad thing at all, because I absolutely hated talking about myself. I was young and naive at the time, so when she announced that we were going to get married a few months later, I guess I just went along with it. No one was more surprised than my betting friends, who had never believed it was remotely possible that I would ever tie the knot, given my painful, awkward shyness with women and my huge passion for solo adventures in the American wilderness. Hardly an aspiring resume for a potential husband. Celeste and I settled down in a small apartment in Seattle that she turned into a cozy, glamorous den with designer furnishings and stylish wallpapers and fabrics. Celeste loved spending many nights out with her girlfriends and never minded me sauntering off on my wilderness excursions because she relished her own space. The reality was that at times in our lives, we were sometimes like water and oil, and we didn't always mix together all that well. Well, not at that time, anyway. I was a manager at the time for a wilderness camping shop, selling all kinds of curious camping gear to outdoorsy, adventurous types of people, while Celeste was an interior designer helping people to recreate a glamorous home, and some of her clients were affluent, high-society types that earned a great deal of money. I was passionate about my job because the store I worked for sold everything, from rifles for hunting, outdoor clothes, hiking shoes, fishing rods, tackle, and all the accessories you could possibly need for camping. I would meet people like myself who were so passionate and excited about the great outdoors, and so my job always involved listening to the stories from people's camping adventures, and believe me, there were many, from strange ghostly encounters to weird sightings of unusual creatures and odd things that happened to them while they were camping. When I would return home at night to Celeste, she would happily talk about herself, prepare a delicious meal for the both of us, telephone her friends, and talk on the telephone for absolute ages about seemingly nothing of any real relevance at all. Then she would retire to bed or watch a little television with me. We really didn't communicate much in those days, nor did we share any interest in common, as Celeste was a social butterfly at the time, and I was introverted and outdoorsy. It was like we were two ships at the time passing in the night that didn't have much interaction together, but I always hoped that one day that would change. On one occasion, Celeste did present me with a hefty life insurance policy to sign. I think given the fact that you're always going off on wilderness excursions, I think it's wise to take out this policy, she advised me. If something dreadful, accidental or fortuitous were to happen to you, God forbid, and you were attacked by a bear or plunge to your death in attempting to climb a high ravine. I don't want to be left penniless, picking up the pieces of my life, especially if I'm a mother with children at the time. That would be awful. What she said was pragmatic and made perfect sense to me, so I signed the life insurance policy willingly, as protecting my wife was a circumspect decision for any man in my position to make. As an outdoorsy type, I had experienced many near-fatal misses in my life that could ultimately have resulted in premature death. I hardly wanted poor Celeste to be an early widow, given that many of my ventures did involve high-scale, sometimes perilous risks. On one occasion I was nearly killed by a black bear, but I successfully played dead, and he lost interest in me. Another time I was stranded in an icy cold Arctic conditions after a nasty fall, and ended up nearly dying of hypothermia, and spent several weeks recuperating in hospital. One day I told my wife Celeste that I was going on a solo camping trip to the Ozarks, and as usual she was fine about my going. On the contrary, she seemed delighted to have me out of her hair for a whole week. I noticed that she seemed unusually interested about whereabouts I would be camping in the Ozarks, so I pointed to her an area on my map where I intended to go exploring. I was actually so pleased that she was showing some interest in my adventure and asking me so many curious questions about my trip and what I intended to do, as that was so out of character for her to appear so enthralled in my outdoor activities. Maybe she was becoming more inquisitive in my pursuits of my outdoor life, I thought happily to myself. Fast forward a couple of days and I was in my utter element. I was in the Ozarks, also known as the Ozark Mountain or Ozark Plateau, in the psychographic region of Missouri, Arkansas, Oklahoma, and the southeast corner of Kansas. The rocks that initially formed the Ozarks are made from sand and silt, with remains of marine animals that were laid down in a shallow sea about 542 million years ago. You can see some of the plant and marine-like fossils embedded within the rocks there when you go swimming in the rock pools, and it is extremely fascinating. Personally, I adore the Ozarks, and this was not my first solo camping trip out there. I love the rugged rocky terrain, the exquisite foaming white plunging waterfalls, the caverns and pools of exquisite cool water, surrounded by magnificent rocky formations, often embedded with fossils like seashells and plant material. I also love the rich terrain of the forest that consisted of primary white oaks, hickory and short-leaved pine, along with the riverbeds where you could find river birch, maple, sycamore, redbud and dogwood. The area was also teeming with wild animals from muskrats, deer, bobcats, otters, bats, and the occasional odd black bear. You also have to watch out for venomous snakes, like the cottonhead, coppermouth, and rattlesnakes, and invariably if you're swimming in one of those glorious rock pools, you'll often spot water snakes skirting across the water, which, believe me, is not an uncommon sight, and is very likely to be seen. It was on the third night camping, and it was very hot, humid, and muggy, which is pretty standard for the Ozarks in the middle of summer, even though tropical rain was common in these parts during the summer, so it could become cloudy and overcast very suddenly. I'm glad to say that luckily I'd not experienced a downfall yet. I was enjoying sleeping in an open hammock under the silvery stars at night. I set up in my sleeping quarters in a very inconspicuous, discreet private area between two white oak trees that were well hidden and extremely well camouflaged. The site was absolutely perfect because it overlooked a large rocky clearing over exquisite waterfalls and the most glorious rock pool that was the most incredible place to cool off in on a hot, scorching summer's day. What could be better? I hadn't prepared a tent for myself because I was really roughing it caveman style. I hid my huge rucksack under piles of leaves so that it remained invisible. I did not want my presence to be clear to the natural wildlife in the area, because when they sense humans are around, they keep a very safe distance. I loved wildlife and was desirous to be one with nature, so blending in with my environment was significant to me. It would seem that despite my near-death experience with a bear once, it had done little to curtail my huge appreciation for animals, and I could quite literally watch animals for hours through my binoculars, and if they sensed my presence, they would not hang around for very long, because invariably they are skittish around humans, and rightfully so. It was about 12 o'clock at night when I awoke, feeling incredibly hot, sticky, sweaty, and clammy, so I decided to take a dip in the cool water of the rock pool. And as I plunged into the water, I felt so refreshed and invigorated. And then I heard it. It was the sound of two pairs of bipedal feet rushing through the undergrowth, walking towards the rock pool where I was actually swimming. I immediately hid in the water under the rocky ledge, taking care not to be observed. It was then that I saw two men, who appeared to be wearing military-style camouflage clothing, known as fatigues, carrying powerful rifles in their hands. It was the conversations that they were having together that made my blood run cold. They were standing so close to where I was hiding that I could have literally reached out to touch their ankles if I'd wanted to. Where the heck is he? How the hell are we going to take him down if we can't even locate him? One of the men was saying. I was informed that he's located in this area and should not be difficult to spot, came another man's voice. Well, we need to get the job done as soon as possible on Maxwell Strick's orders, ASAP. Do you understand? As I was listening to this conversation, I suddenly remembered the life insurance policy that Celeste had urged me to take out, and now I was listening to two men discussing how they were going to murder me. I was utterly horrified. Could this really be happening to me? My heart was racing and my hair stood up on the back of my neck. I felt so violently sick, I just wanted to throw up. I had heard of women who had killed their husbands for life insurance policies before, but I would never have considered Celeste to be that vindictive, malign or evil type of woman who was out for insatiably everything she could get her indulgent hands on. Clearly, I did not know her at all. I watched the men scouting the area and was so relieved that all my camping gear was so well concealed that you would have been forgiven for believing that the whole area was devoid of human habitation. I'd always camped this way before, and now this way of camping was quite literally saving my life. I've always had really great tracking skills, and so I wanted to find out as much as possible as I could about these men. Who on earth was Celeste hiring to kill me? It was absolutely extraordinary that she was going to such extreme lengths to do away with me. I knew I wasn't the greatest husband, but was a huge life insurance policy payout more pleasurable for her than my presence in her life? Such horrendous revelations was a huge slap in the face for me, as I began to realize what a sham my marriage actually appeared to have become. Just when I thought things were looking more promising in our relationship of late. The following day I was very cautious about all my activities, making sure that I did not do anything that could attract attention to myself, and I then heard the men all over again. This time I was in my hammock, well concealed from the clearing. Once again the men were walking towards the same rock pool where I had been swimming the previous night. "Where the hell is he?" I heard one of the men say. "How can something leave no trail whatsoever? How is that even possible?" "Well, maybe he knows we're trying to hunt him down." "I'm the best tracker in the business. I cannot go back to the base and admit that I've failed on this expedition. Failure's not an option for me. That's not going to look good on my meticulous military record. Maxwell has put his full trust in my professional expertise because he knows I can be relied upon to take care of business with no awkward questions asked. I'm considered the most reliable tracker in the military. Read the details again. I want to see if I've overlooked anything." The other man, who I will call George for the purposes of my story, fumbled around in his fatigued trouser pocket and pulled out a crumpled piece of paper that had clearly seen better days. He unrolled the paper and read the following. "It's Operation Ozark Giant, sir. It's a tall human ape-like creature, sir. Approximately 10 foot tall and 1,000 pounds and 5 foot wide, sir. It has 22-inch human-like footprints, sir, and is covered in head to toe with thick black hair, sir. It's powerful, strong, and exceedingly dangerous, with a very potent odour, and it's elusive, sir. Your instructions are to kill it, along with any existing family members, sir, if any are, of course, found. Best locations to look for it are around the Ozark waterfalls, open rock pools, nearby forest or caves, and look out for broken tree stumps and arched pieces of timber, sir." The other military man, who I will call Mike, stroked his moustache in a gesture of thoughtful contemplation. "I wonder why they want us to take him down. I wonder what he's done. Has the creature harmed anyone or caused any mischief? It strikes me that the report is extremely vague. Even that rogue bear that I took down last summer that was causing problems to the locals in the area had a better report than this one is, which is about as indefinite as you can get. The whole thing strikes me as a rather spineless joke. What's the name of the giant creature, did you say? Sasquatch, sir. Mountain giant, said George. Give me the map again, snapped Mike. Where are we? I think we're at this precise point, sir, he said, noting it on the map. Maybe we should turn more to the eastern side of the valley. I think we've not investigated that area thoroughly enough. We can set up camp there tonight, and we can set up a night patrol, sir. I think the creature could potentially be nocturnal, which may be why he has eluded us so far. If he is intelligent, which is a very high probability, considering his distinct humanness, he could be erasing his footprints if he suspects that we are tracking him. Good point. But if this creature is as intelligent as you suppose he is, this expedition is turning out to be a bloody needle in a haystack. How the heck are we to find such an elusive, clever, intelligent creature? You tell me that. Once the men had disappeared from sight, I realized to my huge relief that they weren't actually looking for me, but were hunting some kind of peculiar humanoid ape. I'd been wrong about Celeste. She hadn't been intending to get me killed after all, I thought with huge relief. I determined that these men must be from some military base of some kind, and it sounded exceedingly odd to me that they were looking for such an anomalous, strange-sounding creature. I had never heard of such an atypical beast existing here in North America before. I had explored North America so very well, and knew all the animals in explicit detail that frolicked our woods, and a humanoid ape was definitely not one of those critters that I had ever encountered in all my travels. Surely this was some great big wind-up, I thought, chuckling to myself. Yes, that's probably what it was. The military were well known for their warped sense of humour, but this was possibly taking things a teensy-weensy bit overboard, as far as a wind-up was concerned. That night I retired to my hammock very early. I had made a fire pit as I knew these men were far away by now. I killed a rabbit and skinned it, roasting it over the grill and flavouring it with my mixed seasoning. It tasted exactly like roast chicken and was melt in the mouth, juicy and delicious. I immediately pulled my fire pit apart and smoothed the area down and covered myself with a natural citronella lemongrass insect repellent and proceeded to lie down in my hammock, covering myself with a sopping wet towel. It was such a hot, humid night, and very difficult to fall asleep when the weather is this clammy and unpleasant, and the flying, biting insects don't make life any easier either, as far as acquiring a good night's sleep is concerned. I did manage to drift off to sleep with the help of my wet towel that helped my body temperature to plummet, thus enabling me to get some well-needed shut-eye. I was suddenly awoken to the loud noise of splashing in the water, and I could hear the strange chattering sound that sounded as if someone was speaking gibberish, but it sounded like several people jabbering all at once in this very strange language. There was also a horrible stench in the air that smelt a little bit like sweaty trainers and wet dogs. What the heck, I thought to myself as I sprang into action and gathered my Remington rifle. I crept silently through the trees, taking fastidious care to be as soundless as I could. I stepped ever closer to the rocky pool with the magnificent white foaming cascading waterfalls, and that was when I saw them. There were four massive creatures that at first glance looked exactly like bears, but then I realized they were more like human giants, covered with long, flowing, dark hair. They were all playing together in the rocky pool excitedly, chattering together garrulously in a language of some kind, and the dialogue was continuous, as they seemed to love to chat. I realized at once that it was a mother, father, and two children, and they were without doubt the humanoid apes that those military men had been authorized and instructed and commanded to kill by their superiors at a military base of some kind. This very thought made me sick to my stomach, because to me killing these creatures was unequivocally tantamount to murder. The behaviour of these remarkable, powerful, majestic, loftic humanoids was so human-like, it was extraordinary. I kept up close to the rock pool, hiding behind a large rocky outcrop, to watch them very closely. They were the most unbelievable, exciting, curious creatures that I have ever encountered in my entire life, because they were incredibly intelligent. I was in luck because it was a bright full moon, and it was so light, and such a crisp, beautiful evening, with great visibility because of the starry firmament that provided the most phenomenal lighting over the rock pool. They clearly possessed human emotions and feelings, which were seen by the way they interacted together. They were tactile and affectionate, and very much a close, loving family unit. I could see that the alpha male, or father, was the authority, and he was titanic in his immense size and stature. I would say he was easily 11 foot tall, and well over 1,000 pounds, and possibly more, while the female was 8 foot, and the children only about 6 foot tall. The creatures were absolute incredible swimmers, and their long shaggy hair was surprisingly no hindrance at all to their swimming prowess and capability. I think they were hot on this muggy night, which was why they came to swim in the rock pool in the first place, and they all took it in turns to stand under the showering current of the waterfall. I could tell that they were really enjoying the feeling of the invigorating water pulsating across their bodies like an invigorating punnelling massage. I noticed that their hairless grey faces were so human-like, but with a prominent brow ridge and very deep-set brown eyes that appeared to take on a red eyeshine in the dark. The critters were really enjoying themselves splashing around in the water, and if you took away the long hair and reduced their sizes considerably, it would be no different to watching a human family interacting and playing together. Sometimes they would make these happy whooping sounds, which I would liken to jubilant, joyful human laughter. I watched the creatures climb out of the water with such grace and agility. They shook their shaggy-like coats like dogs, sending a shower of rain over a long, rocky area. They continued to chatter together while gliding away on their long, graceful legs, and they moved with such fluid grace and agility. They were superb to watch. Suddenly after they had gone, the revelation that these military men I had seen could potentially kill those beautiful creatures sent waves of horror and dread into every fibre of my being. It would be tantamount to murder in my book, and I knew that they had to be stopped. So I hatched up an inspirational, cunning plan in my head and went in search for the men, knowing that they were camping in an easterly direction. At first light I arose very early in the morning, and immediately, armed with my compass and map, I hiked for a few long hours with a rucksack on my back, until I found myself walking towards the campsite of the two military men. The two men appeared surprised to see me. "Who are you?" they asked me, looking at me in surprise. "Oh, I'm just solo camping out here," I said. "It's just nice to see another human face. It's been a long while, you see." I could see the men physically relax, and they warmly, cordially invited me to join them for a cup of tea around their fire pit. "So how long have you been out here?" Mike asked me curiously. "A while," I lied, "and I've seen some things I'd rather forget out here."
"Such as what?" asked Mike, raising a quizzical eyebrow.
"Well, you wouldn't believe me if I was to tell you," I said.
"Tell us," said Mike, trying to hide his rising excitement that I could distinctly hear in his voice.
"Well, I saw a couple of men killing a very big family of black humanoid hairy apes. I heard them say, 'We've cleaned the whole area out of these horrible critters,' I said as I watched a horrified expression appear on Mike's face as he listened to me very intently. I continued, "I never knew that animals like this existed in North America before, but I did see these four dead corpses of these black hairy ape humanoids myself," I lied.
"You saw them yourself?
And are you sure they're dead?" asked Mike, failing to hide his delight. "Oh, yes," I said. "They were as dead as dodos, and these men loaded these colossal critters into a truck and sped away just like that."
"Did they say where they were taking them?" asked Mike, looking frightfully concerned for a moment.
"To be incinerated as quickly as possible," I said. "They wanted to keep what they'd done very, very hush-hush, away from prying and questioning human eyes, I gather, and they wanted me to keep my mouth shut too."
"We believe your story," said Mike, looking very solemn. "But our advice is that you don't tell anyone what you saw, because people will think you're cuckoo and should be locked away in a loony bin, if you get my drift."
"Oh, I do," I said. "Most certainly."
"May I suggest that you don't tell anybody what you told us?"
"Oh, you're right," I told them both. "I wouldn't tell anybody what I've told you. I think I just sensed you both would believe me, but normally I would never share such stories with anyone, lest they think I'm bonkers."
"Glad to hear it," said Mike. "How can you be sure those creatures are dead?" he continued. "Are you really certain of this fact?"
"I've been a hunter all my life," I said. "I think I can tell when an animal is dead, or when it's just passed out."
The men seemed satisfied by my adamancy. I drank my tea and ate a couple of chocolate biscuits that they had given me. I then left the men and thanked them for their hospitality, and then I proceeded to hide behind the cover of a tree to listen to their conversation and to make absolutely certain that they would not consider hunting down those beautiful humanoid apes. I hoped that my bogus story had convinced them that the humanoid apes were indeed dead.
"Well, it would seem someone has taken care of our job for us," said Mike. "I told you that those critters were no longer around. I would have discovered their tracks by now, did I not tell you? It's just as well we ran into the man, and he told us that the critters are clearly dead, or we could have been running around in circles for ages, looking for those things, with absolutely no results."
"Yes, boss, it would appear so."
"Now you're not to tell anyone that we did not kill those Ozark giants ourselves. We will simply tell them we've taken care of business. That's all we need to say. That way we'll be esteemed very highly and even promoted. So no divulging any details about this case. Do you understand? Why should some stranger take credit when the army would not know the difference anyway? So no spilling the beans. Get my drift?"
"Oh, of course, sir," said George. "We'll simply say we attended to business, like you say, sir."
"Good man," said Mike, tapping him on the back in a condescending way. "I knew I could trust you." I watched the two men pack away their tents into their rucksacks and leave the area, falsely believing that the humanoid apes had indeed been killed. So there you are. That's my extraordinary story. And I'm glad to say that I played my part in hopefully saving that beautiful family of forest giants that deserved a life just like the rest of us do. You'll be surprised to learn that all these years later I am still married to Celeste, and it would appear that over the years our relationship literally blossomed. Initially we had so very little in common, and it rarely looked doubtful that our relationship would work, but then suddenly one day it just did. I fell madly in love with her about 10 years into our marriage. She suddenly changed, and I guess I did too. Maybe we just grew up, matured, and instead of growing apart, we grew together. I think Celeste overcame her self-centered behavior and developed a more spiritual attitude to life. She developed into a very beautiful woman over the years, and I loved her more than ever. I always tell her that she improved with age, rather like a good quality wine. At first she was fruity, light, and rather naive, but now she's full-bodied, mature, and infinitely superior. I'm also glad to report that I do not go on camping trips alone these days, because Celeste has developed a passion for outdoor adventures and excursions, and she adores visiting the Ozarks as much as I do, and swimming in those glorious rock pools, and cooking gnocchi and garlic and parmesan in a pot over a warm grill. Oh, and I do still have a hefty life insurance policy taken out on me. But I assure you that if Celeste wanted to do away with me, she'd have done away with me a very long time ago. She relentlessly teases me about the time that I thought she had hired someone to kill me or do me in. I now know all these years later that the creatures I encountered in the Ozark were indeed Bigfoot, Sasquatch, Yeti or Hairy Man. And I do realise how remarkably privileged I was to have such an amazing encounter with these incredible hairy critters that I believe are the most wonderful creatures. I am sure, much like the human species, you get good and bad creatures. But the family I watched playing in the rocky pool so happily together
was no threat at all to human safety. I am certain of this fact, or I wouldn't have gone so far or to such extraordinary measures to protect them from the military. So that is my story. Well, I just want to thank you so very much for that amazing story, and I do think you saved those hairy humanoids that we like to call Bigfoot or Sasquatch. And I just want to know, are there any people out there that do believe that the military do get involved in killing Bigfoots? Because this isn't the first time I've heard this. Until next time, goodbye and good night.